My castaway this week is a film director. Born into the magnificence of Imperial Vienna at the beginning of this century, his early ambition was to be a musician. But, inspired by the work of men like Eisenstein and Stroheim, he chose the cinema instead, and in 1929 emigrated to the United States. His career since then is a living history of Hollywood. He's won 5 Oscars and worked with all the great names, from Spencer Tracy and Grace Kelly to Vanessa Redgrave and Sean Connery. His 21 feature films include some of the most popular and durable ever made, films such as High Noon, From Here to Eternity, Oklahoma, and A Man for All Seasons. He is Fred Zinnemann. Do you feel those films, Mr. Zinnemann, and so many more, The Nun Story and The Day of the Jackal, do you feel they're still very much a part of you, or are they just labels that people pull out with your name?
They are part of me, of course, but it's the distant past. At my age, I'm 83, it's all very far away, really.
Do you have them all on tape? Do you watch them?
I don't watch them if I can help it. I sometimes look out of curiosity when they're played on the TV.
But you don't have them, recordings of them tucked away in a cupboard somewhere?
I have 2 or 3. I have High Noon because somebody gave it to me, and I have Oklahoma because I like the music. But by and large, I don't spend too much time on reminiscing.
But, of course, you might never have been a film director. As I was saying, you might have been a doctor or a physician, indeed, if your parents had had their way.
That's right, yes. The reason for that was that in Vienna, you have to have the title of doctor if you want to amount to anything. You have to be a doctor of something, whether it's theology or philosophy or medicine or whatever. My father was a doctor, but after the First World War, times were very difficult for physicians. There were too many of them. And so the family decided I ought to study law. And I must say I hated it. I found it intensely boring. Instead of going to lectures, I went to movies.
But before you were inspired by the cinema, I think you really wanted to be a musician, didn't you?
Yes, that was my first love, so to speak. In Austria, as you probably know, everybody plays one instrument, at least. My father was a very, very good viola player. We used to have a lot of chamber music at home.
But what instrument did you play?
I tried to play the violin with disastrous results. My baby brother, who was 2 years old, would burst into tears each time I played the violin, and we also had a small fox terrier who would howl, and this was very discouraging. You can love music without music loving you back.
So what record would be the first that you would put on your record player, wind-up gramophone on the desert island?
One of my earliest impressions is a piece by Mozart, which my father, who played the viola, and my violin teacher played together. It's a piece for orchestra, but they played it just as it went, because obviously there was no orchestra in the house. But it's a beautiful, beautiful thing, and that's what woke me up, so to speak.
Joseph Suk, playing part of the first movement of Mozart's Sinfonia Concertante in E-flat major with the Prague Chamber Orchestra. So Vienna, before the First World War, Fred Zinnemann, music was a way of life, you said. You were steeped in it. Tell me about the atmosphere after the war as opposed to before. How did it change?
What was really difficult was that the Austrians themselves, the Viennese especially, couldn't get used to the idea of not having an empire. It was a little bit like what happened here after England lost the colonies. I found that people for quite a while couldn't get used to the idea that there wasn't an empire anymore.
So there was a huge amount of nostalgia for...
There was enormous nostalgia. People were looking back to the good old days and couldn't get going.
And the self-pity?
Enormous self-pity. Enormous self-pity. And also a refusal to look ahead. And they were like a bunch of canary birds sitting in a cage. The door was open, but they wouldn't fly out.
And what of anti-Semitism? How blatant was that in Vienna?
Anti-Semitism is something that's endemic in Austria. It's always been there. And when there's a crisis, it flares up.
So it flared up then in 1918 and on into the 20s. How much did you and your family suffer as a result?
It wasn't really suffering. It was just more the feeling of being an outsider, in the sense that while you were educated exactly as the non-Jewish kids, there was nevertheless some sort of a distance between us. And gradually there were snide remarks being made and gradually fist fights. Then boys started coming in with swastikas in the lapels. I remember saying to one of them, "Aren't you ashamed to wear this?" And he said, "I'm proud of it." And it just gradually came to that, but it was still very far on the horizon. And Hitler was a man, originally people laughed at him. They thought that he was crazy. And it gradually changed.
So you, during this time, were a young boy in your teens.
Teenager, yes.
And you were to get out and escape from it all, as we'll hear. But I wonder how much that whole experience, that Austria of your youth, influenced the rest of your life.
It's a very good question. I think it influenced me enormously, because I always felt drawn to subjects in which the leading character is some sort of an outsider. But it doesn't quite belong, and sometimes doesn't want to belong, or sometimes is even against. But the theme of the outsider is something that I always, it works on me.
Shall we have your second record?
All right. This is something I really wanted to talk about briefly. The Vienna Philharmonic, and the conductor at the time was the king of all conductors, Furtwängler. And we had what they call an abonnement, which meant that you could go every week and listen to this. And I remember Furtwängler, after he had played the Ninth Symphony, went to ask him for an autograph. And he gave me the autograph and patted me on the head. And this was a central experience in my life. And I didn't wash my head for about 3 weeks after that.
Ode to Joy from the final movement of Beethoven's Symphony No. 9 with the Bayreuth Festival Chorus and Orchestra conducted by Wilhelm Furtwängler. So the young Fred Zinnemann was bored to tears with his studies for the law, couldn't do justice on the violin to his beloved music, and went to the cinema instead. What kind of films were popular at that time?
Chaplin was enormously popular. Garbo's first two films had come out and she was an overnight sensation. There were a number of German films that were also very popular. Some excellent German directors who had come up. And so was Saint Joan of Arc, which was a great, great masterpiece.
Whose film was that? Carl Dreyer.
He was a Danish director. And Eisenstein, who had already introduced the whole concept of montage, making films based on the editing. Various films of that kind. King Vidor was another man who... He had done The Big Parade, which was a great hit at that time. The second part of that today is still a masterpiece.
Thank you.
So what was it that you saw in those films that made you know you wanted to spend your life in the cinema?
I just had a feeling that I could contribute in some way, that I could make it go, make it work.
But your parents, your family, were very dubious about it, weren't they?
Well, you can't be a doctor as a film director, you know. There was no doctorate of film. So
No Herr Dr. Eisenstein.
Nothing like that. And also, at that time, people looked down on films, you know. They thought it was sort of ill repute.
Didn't they also think that you rather fancied the cinema because you fancied the girls?
My mother did, yes, absolutely, of course.
Was there some truth in that?
Up to a point, yes.
Well, so they let you go to Paris eventually, didn't they?
Yes.
To study cinematography. That was 1927.
That's
and
right,
you
yes.
were 20 years old.
That's right.
And 18 months later, you sailed for America. Did you ever see your family again?
Yes. I came back in 1931 for about a year because Robert Flaherty, known as the grandfather of the documentary, said I could be his assistant if I came back from Hollywood to Europe, which I did. And I worked with him for about 6 months. And I learned more from him than from anybody else, even though the film never happened. And even though we didn't really do much work other than test cameras, mostly we sat and drank beer in the Adlon Hotel bar. And sitting there listening to him, I was influenced sufficiently by what he was about to become a maverick director.
But you took that opportunity of being back in Europe to revisit your family in Vienna.
Yes, yes.
1931.
And they also came to see me in Berlin. So that was the last time I saw them. And if you don't mind, I would just as soon not talk about the rest of it because they all wound up in Auschwitz. And this is I'd prefer just to leave it alone, if you don't mind.
What's your next record?
That is a piece of music that made a tremendous impression on me when I first heard it, because it seemed to be a new language in music, so that it somehow contributed to my feeling about music. it's almost as though he was prophesying what was going to happen in the 20th century when you listen to that music.
That was the opening of Mahler's Symphony No. 2 in C minor, played by the Philharmonia Orchestra, conducted by Otto Klemperer. Let's talk about you arriving in New York. You were 22 years old. What were your first impressions?
I was overwhelmed. What happened was that I arrived on Black Thursday, which was the day that started the Great Depression. And around the corner from where we were docking, the stockbrokers were jumping out of the windows. So that was rather ominous.
But within 2 weeks of arriving in the United States, I think you set out for the very home of movie-making itself,
yes.
For Hollywood, didn't
yes.
you? Did you have anything or anyone to recommend you?
Yes, I had one introduction to the head of Universal Studios, who was a gentleman by the name of Carl Laemmle. I came and saw him, and he was terribly nice, didn't know what to do with me, and pushed a button, and the casting director came in, who took me over and said, have you been in the German army? And I said, I was too young. And he said, well, never mind, we are making a war picture and you can be in it. And so I became a German soldier, and the picture was All Quiet on the Western Front. And I was there for 6 weeks, and then talked back to the assistant director and got fired.
So you might have been, it might have been Fred Zinnemann the actor, might it?
Never, never, no.
Was that your one and only experience of being in front of the camera?
Yes, yes.
What was the first film that you directed, actually, all on your own?
It was a pure documentary of the life of fishermen in the Gulf of Mexico. It was supposed to be an educational film because in those days, people in Mexico didn't know much about each other. They were very isolated, and the then government, which was very progressive, wanted to educate the fishermen about how the miners lived and so forth.
So your whole beginnings, apart from a brief appearance in All Quiet on the Western Front, was documentary training?
The start was documentary, yes.
And do you think that has influenced your approach to filmmaking
enormously,
for the rest of your life?
Enormously, because, for instance, in The Nun's Story, not being a Catholic, I didn't know very much about it. And while the church in the beginning was not very forthcoming, for very good reasons, they later became very generous. And I spent one whole year in preparation to get a feeling of the rhythm of how it all worked. And the rhythm, in a curious way, is one of the most important things that you have to study, because it's different in every country. And the behavior of people is different in every country. If you take an example, if two cars collide, have a small collision in England or in Rome or in Paris, in Rome you'll see people jump out terribly excited, threatening to kill each other and then backing off. In England, they are very polite and they take note of the insurance. In Paris, they kill each other. And things like that, you know, you get so that you can be in an empty street and very far away you can see a man and a girl talking to each other. And you can tell whether he's trying to persuade her to go to bed with him or whether she's asking him not to leave her or whether they're just in love or they already have been together for a long time. And you can see it just in the way they stand. You don't have to hear it.
one of your great films, High Noon. It's actually quite a kind of factual approach you have there, a documentary approach you have there, don't you? Because the lighting is very flat. Gary Cooper was very unglamorous, really. He was a middle-aged man with a problem, wasn't he, as
yes,
you shot him?
Yes, quite right. I did want to make it look as though it was a newsreel. And you saw a white sky and a flat lighting and very grainy texture. And fortunately, the cameraman was very brave because after the second day of shooting, there were complaints about the lousy photography. And it wasn't I who was paying his salary. So he was really defying the front office. And he kept right on doing what we had agreed. It didn't buckle, it didn't compromise.
Do not forsake me, oh my darling, on this our wedding day. Do not forsake me, oh my darling, wait, wait long. The noonday train will bring Frank Miller. If I'm a man, I must be brave, and I must face that deadly killer. Are I a coward, a craven coward? Are I a coward in my grave? Oh, to be torn twixt love and duty, supposing I lose my fair beauty. Look at that big hand move along near in High Noon. He made a vow while in the state's prison, married would be my life or his, and I'm not afraid of death, but oh, what will I do if you leave me? Do not forsake me, oh my darling. You made that promise when we wed. Do not forsake me, oh my darling. Although you're grieving, I can't be leaving until I shoot Frank Miller dead. Wait long, wait long, wait long, wait long.
Let's have some more music.
Well, it's by Galuppi, and it's a piano sonata played by Calandrelli. A very simple piece of music which I love dearly. It's also a piece of music which my wife likes very much.
Arturo Benedetti Michelangeli playing the opening of Galuppi's Sonata No. 5 in C major. You used, Fred Zinnemann, quite a few unknown actors early on in your career. Your second feature film, The Search, starred an unknown called Montgomery Clift, and after that came The Men in 1949 with a fellow called Brando. Now, why did you want to do that? Why did you want these unknowns?
To talk about Clift first, we were making a film called The Search, which was to deal with children who had come out of concentration camps, etc., one of whom is picked up by an American soldier. And this was not the kind of theme that was suitable for a star, and the star would have killed it anyway because people would have looked at it as a vehicle and it wouldn't have added up to anything. So we needed somebody unknown. And I was fortunate enough to, through a friend of mine, Peter Vettel, to hear about a young stage actor by the name of Montgomery Clift. And I met Clift and found him absolutely marvelous. And the script called for a soldier who was an engineer in the engineering thing. And he insisted on being with an engineering outfit, not just being in the army. He had never been in the army. Anyway, he did so well that when the film was finally shown, someone said to me, "Where did you find a soldier who could act so well?"
It's a great compliment.
It's a great compliment, yes.
What about Brando? Was he as careful in his approach?
Of Brando, who had just been very successful on the Broadway stage, he came out trusting nobody. He had heard horror stories about Hollywood and was very much on the defensive, but eventually loosened up. Anyway, he also, being a method actor, prepared himself so thoroughly that he spent 3 weeks on the ward with paralyzed war veterans, with the result that only doctors and nurses knew that he was not really a paraplegic. Nobody else could tell the difference. Some of these boys were able to go out in town, and he went with them, with one group.
In a wheelchair?
They all came and went in wheelchairs and had their drinks and came back. As you may know, California always was known for having a lot of religious freaks. On this particular day, the group was in a bar, and a woman who had had too much to drink came in and spotted the group and came and sat on the bar stool and told them if they had any faith in God, they would all walk. The boys said, "Well, talk to him," pointing to Brando. And Brando, I'm told, gave the performance of his career. All he did was look doubtful. And just that shadow of a doubt made the woman very eager to talk to him. And the more she talked, the more doubtful he got. And after a while, everything started slowing down because people became aware of it. And everybody looked and listened, and waiters stood there with their trays, and it was a tableau. And finally, Brando couldn't stand it. And so with a gigantic effort, he stood up. And there was a hush in the place because people thought it was a miracle. So at this point, the woman sobered up. And at this point, Brando couldn't stand and started to laugh. And he danced the jig and walked out. And then came back with a lot of newspapers and said, "Hooray, now I can make a living."
Thank you.
Shall we have your next record?
Well, leaving Europe and coming to America was an enormous jump in many ways, especially when it came to music. I was terribly excited not to hear the same old polite classical music, but to find the exciting, vibrant, wonderful type of music. As an example, I'd like you to hear Cab Calloway singing Menu de Mucho to explain what I'm talking about.
Folks, now here's a story about Minnie the Moocher. She was a red-hot hoochie-coocher. She was the roughest, toughest rail. But Minnie had a heart as big as a hay whale. Howdy, howdy, ho.
Howdy, howdy, ho.
Howdy, howdy,
ho. Howdy, howdy, ho.
She loved him though he was cocky. He took her down to Chinatown. He showed her how to kick the gong around.
Cab Calloway and Minnie the Moocher.
I love that.
It's good fun.
Oh, wonderful.
1953, From Here to Eternity. Well, now, there's a film that's remembered for so many reasons, but not least because, of course, it launched Frank Sinatra on his acting career, didn't it? Where did you find him?
Frank Sinatra had already been a star for a long time, musically speaking. He'd made two or three films which were not good, and he also had family trouble, and he was very, very down. Anyhow, there was Sinatra, who was at that point in Africa with Ava Gardner, who was making a movie with John Ford, Mugambo. And Harry Cohn, who was a very, very careful man with a buck, let Sinatra know that if he came back at his own expense and make a test, that perhaps he could have the job. So we made a test, and Frank was very good. He was Sinatra in uniform and was himself. And I was very happy to have him because he was very entertaining and charming and not easy, but fine.
Of course, one of the other things that the film is remembered for is that marvellous scene in the surf between Deborah Carr and Burt Lancaster.
Yes.
Rolling passionately on the edge of the sea. That was quite avant-garde, really, for 1953.
Well, apparently this was really the reason why everybody thought that this would be a successful movie. You know, I thought it was fine. It was all right. It was a perfectly simple scene to shoot.
Was it?
Nothing to it. Well, the two people were lying on the beach, and you just waited for the right wave to come in, and when the wave started coming in, you turned over the camera.
Yes, but the right wave mightn't come until the sixth or eighth wave, by which time they were kind of bedraggled and looking
well,
not very
you sort of watched it, you know. I mean, that's the easiest part of it. And the actors seemed to do what came naturally, and there was no problem at all. Nothing. We shot in no time.
Playing this, the part of Karen Holmes in From Here to Eternity, over and above the famous love scene on the beach, which had never been done before, and which is still, I think, one of the most erotic scenes that you can give. Take all your movies in which they've all got all their clothes off, and that it wasn't in the least as sort of curiously exciting in a very subtle and very erotic manner. And it was a terrific scene, and Zinnemann directed it marvellously, and Burt was wonderful in it, and the setting was great, of course. But it kind of broke that little cast, that little mould for me. And, I went on to do all other kinds of things, although I played many ladies and many nuns and many spinsters since.
But it does strike me that there are times when it's quite fun to be a film director, yes?
I think it's mostly fun. It's mostly fun, or it's so tragic that it becomes surrealist, but you still have to laugh at it, you know? And you know the old saying about the difference between Germans and Austrians, don't you? The Germans say the situation is serious, but not hopeless. And the Austrians say the situation is hopeless but not serious.
Which makes you ever an optimist in these situations?
It does. You have to be an optimist. Or it helps to be an optimist. It does.
You vowed your love from here to eternity. A love so true, it never would die. You gave your lips, gave them so willingly. How could I know? Your kiss meant goodbye. Now I'm alone with only a memory. My empty arms will never know why. That you left with me will live from here to eternity. Now I'm alone with only my empty arms will never know why. Though you are gone, this love that you left with me, this endless desire, to eternity.
Another record.
Oh, more American music. One of the things that struck me very strongly very early on was Gershwin's Rhapsody in Blue, which somehow has the whole spirit of New York as it was then.
George Gershwin's Rhapsody in Blue, played by the Los Angeles Philharmonic Orchestra, conducted by Leonard Bernstein. You said earlier, Fred Zinnemann, that you've always naturally been attracted by stories about the outsider, the lone voice against the masses, and that, of course, is certainly true of the films we've been talking about, High Noon, From Here to Eternity. But where does one of your other great films, Oklahoma, fit into all of that?
Well, that is probably has to do with the fact that when you are in a very temporary situation of being what is called a hot director, everybody wants you. that they want you, no matter what it is they want you for, whether it's a comedy, if you've never done a comedy or whatever. And by some gigantic miscalculation, I was offered Oklahoma after From Here to Eternity, which pleased me no end, first of all, because I was very interested. I loved the music. It was lovely. And I also liked the enormous optimism that the piece represented in the early days of the war when everything was very sad. Suddenly, like a beam of sunlight, that musical came on with all this optimism and all the faith in America and all that. And so anyway, emotionally, I was all for it. And I thought I could take a chance and experiment.
So why do you call it a gigantic miscalculation?
Well, I was just being facetious, actually.
Well, indeed, the film got an Oscar nomination, I think, didn't it?
Yes, yeah. Mm.
A lot of the old black and white greats these days are subjected to a process called colorizing, aren't
yes.
they? And indeed, they're often re-edited, I think, to make them shorter.
Oh, yes, yes.
Do you approve of all of that, or do you rather resent your work being fiddled about with?
Yeah, I think it's a sign of the times. I think it has to do with the fact that everybody seems to try to squeeze the last penny out of anything, no matter what the consequences.
Do I also infer from everything that you said that you were never really in films, in the cinema, for the money? That wasn't really your motivation, or indeed one of them.
Well, it, don't misunderstand. It isn't that I don't like money. Obviously it does, but it's not the end all. It's not. We are not here just to make money or sell each other things we don't need. I think there must be another reason while we are here, and I don't think it's an accident. You wouldn't have things like the Ninth Symphony or the Pyramids or the Acropolis if it were an accident. And this whole idea of money becoming a religion is something that we are going to have to pay for very dearly at some point, I'm afraid, even though I'm an optimist.
Record number 7.
Oh, Leadbelly. Leadbelly was one of the first musical experiences had in America. Leadbelly himself, as you probably know, was a convict and had worked in a chain gang because he had killed somebody. And he's a great musician and a force of nature. He has an enormous exuberance, enormous joy of life, an enormous vitality. And his humor, you can hear it when you hear the song, Green Corn.
Green corn, green corn, green corn, come on, Charlie. Green corn, what a corn to your father. Green corn, green corn. All I want is creation. Little bit of white, big salation. Two little boys call me Papa. My name's Tom, no one named Gravy. Green corn. Green corn, come on, Charlie. Green corn, don't you follow. Green corn, come on, Charlie. Green corn. Boys call me Papa. Name Tom, no one named Gravy. One name Tom, no one named Gravy. One going to put him, the other going to save it. Green corn. Green corn.
Leadbelly and Green Corn. You made your last feature film 8 years ago now?
Yes.
5 Days, One Summer.
That's right.
Up in the mountains with
Yes.
Sean Connery.
Yes.
You haven't made a film since then?
No.
Do you miss it?
Yes.
Could you? Would you make another one?
Yes. Of course, I'm 80, going on 84, and so perhaps I won't have the time to do another one.
Now, in the meantime, we ship you away to your desert island. Are you going to sit there happily on the island, or is escape high on the agenda, if only to make another film?
I could swim for it. I can't swim very well, but I could try.
And you're an optimist, aren't you?
Exactly.
And why would you want to escape? I mean, what is it that you would want to return to? Who or what is it that you need?
Well,
I
just don't like to be a vegetable and just sit there. It's no way to live. You know, it can just take so much sunshine. So I think after a week I would have had it.
So you'd swim for it. Shall we have the last record?
This record is something that I've known for a very long time, and I never get tired of it, ever. I could play it any hour of day or night and be thrilled by it. And of all the records, I think it's the one I would like to hear most often.
Thank you.
Bach's Magnificat with the Munich Bach Orchestra and Chorus, conducted by Karl Richter. So your book, you've got the complete works of Shakespeare and you've got the Bible on the island. What other book would you like?
War and Peace, which is a great, great book. Woody Allen said that he had taken a speed reading course and that he found that he could read War and Peace in 15 minutes. And he said it's about Russia.
Well, you've got a whole week to read it, by your own judgment.
Right.
What about a luxury?
A very large, self-renewing bottle of scotch.
Everlasting. Fred Zinnemann, thank you very much indeed for letting us hear your Desert Island Discs.
It's been a great pleasure, great pleasure.